chapter 3, verses 7 through 17, which you can find on page 50 in the Old Testament section of the Pew Bible. Then the Lord said, I have observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry on account of their taskmasters. Indeed, I know their sufferings, and I have come to deliver them from the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the country of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. The cry of the Israelites has now come to me. I have also seen how the Egyptians oppressed them. So come, I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? He said, I will be with you, and this shall be the sign for you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall worship God on this mountain. But Moses said to God, if I come to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your ancestors has sent me to you, and they ask me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. He said further, thus you shall say to the Israelites, I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, thus you shall say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent you. This is my name forever, and this is my title for all generations. Go and assemble the elders of Israel and say to them, the Lord, the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob, has appeared to me, saying, I have given heed to you and to what has been done to you in Egypt. I declare that I will bring you up out of the misery of Egypt to the land of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites, a land flowing with milk and honey. The epistle reading is from Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 11, which you can find on page 155 in the Pew Bible. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope is because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us, and that while we still were sinners, Christ died for us. Much more surely then, now that we have been justified by his blood, we'll be saved through him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son, much more surely, having been reconciled, will we be saved by his life. But more than that, we even boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. And finally, the gospel reading is from John chapter 18, verses 1 through 8, which is on page 112 of the Pew Bible. After Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed them, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers, together with priests from the chief priests and the Pharisees, and they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them, whom are you looking for? They answered, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus replied, I am he. Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, I am he, they stepped back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them, whom are you looking for? And they said, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus answered, I told you that I am he. So if you are looking for me, let these men go.
Anae, Sophia, Jackson, Emma, Aiden, Olivia, Lucas, Liam, Mia, Noah, Isabella, Ethan, Riley, Mason, Lily. Do any of these names sound familiar? Perhaps you have children or grandchildren with these names, because they come from the list 2016 top 10 list of baby names. Some of you may have looked at one of those lists in naming your children, or know someone who has. I myself was tempted to look at one of those lists when I was naming my first child, but being the stubborn person I was, I thought I would come up with the name myself. For those of you who know what my daughter's name is, you will know that it resulted in one thing, a fairly common name, but a misspelling of it. For those of you who don't know, her name is Kylie, spelled K-Y-L-E. Now, even this year, as we hung her ornaments on the Christmas tree, several of those ornaments hung with the correct spelling of her name, K-Y-L-I-E. You know, when it came to naming our second child, I decided that I would leave that responsibility up to my husband. Now, some of you may have seen at festivals or fairs or other places those booths that offer those frames with a name in it and their description of the meaning of the name below it. When I was a kid, my dad owned a business that did just that. So I would go along, and it never ceased to amaze me how many, most of the time it was colleges, but how many students and other people were so interested in knowing the meaning of their name or didn't know the meaning of their name. Some people don't find knowing the meaning of their name important, yet others believe you can live into the characteristics of your name. So much so that there are websites dedicated to explaining the characteristics of each name. Now, I wanted to take a closer look at one of those top 10 names. So let us use Lily. Now, as it turns out, I know someone who named their child Lily because they thought it sounded nice. So I went to one of those websites and I searched what the name Lily meant. And of course, as we expect, it is derived from the flower as a symbol of purity. But unfortunately for Lily's parents, Lily didn't exactly live into the characteristics of her name. Even as a young child, she challenged her parents. As a teenager, she became even more rebellious. Purity and beautiful flower were not characteristics that people would use to describe Lily. But over time, her parents would learn characteristics that helped them love her for who she was. But not all parents pick names because they sound good. A few years after my son was born, I had a conversation with an aunt. She was telling me how the niece on her side of the family had brought the baby home before naming the child. We thought this was so odd, we didn't even know that it was allowed. She claimed she wanted to see the characteristics of the child before naming the child. The idea of characteristics being used to help someone name their child may seem foreign to us in America, but in many cultures, and in the time that this is being read to the audience that is being read to, it was common practice. The Bible also offers us examples of times when God changed people's names to give them a new identity. For example, Abram turns to Abraham, father of nations. His wife Sarai to Sarah, mother of nations. Jacob is named Israel because he wrestles with God. And finally, Jesus changes Simon's name to Peter, meaning rock, which he could build his church. But in order to understand the importance of naming God, which occurs in our reading, we must also understand the importance of the usage of the tetragrammaton that I taught the kids about a little earlier, the YHWH. we see this Yahweh appear as a name for God. In fact, Yahweh appears 6,823 times in the Bible. But I want to point out one of those times in particular, in Genesis 4:26, where it is said that the first civilization began to invoke the name of Yahweh. The first time we see the name of Yahweh. Yahweh is translated in many Bibles as Lord in all capitals. And in post-biblical times, the name Yahweh in Jewish communities is not to be said aloud. The name is so reverent to this Jewish community that you don't say it. It is a word, it is a name that our imaginations can think, our minds can comprehend, but our mouths should not say. In short, Yahweh is important in the divine name for God, but it cannot be the defining name for God. But before we can go further into exploring the naming of God, we must first have some information about the setting that is going on before this revealing of God's name. At the beginning of Exodus chapter 3, we find Moses is to have noticed a bush that is burning, but not being consumed by the fire. And out of this bush, Moses is called by God. And Moses responds, "Here I am." God tells Moses, "Take off your sandals because you are standing on holy ground." Moses immediately hides his face. We know that because he hides his face, that he must have understood this God. Because he would have been taught the Israelite understanding that if you saw God, it meant imminent death. But even though Moses shows fear of this God, in verse 13 of our passage today, he boldly asks God a question. This is what he says. "If I come to the Israelites and say to them, 'The God of your ancestors has sent me to you,' and they ask me, 'What is his name?' what shall I say to them?" Moses realizes that if he comes to this group of people without a name or without characteristics associated with that name, that God cannot exist. You see, in the Hebrew language, in order for a deity to exist, it must be able to be experienced. Even his Egyptian background would teach him this. As Carol Myers, a professor at Duke, points out, in a document from the 19th dynasty in Egypt, we see the importance of naming to those societies. The document tells the story of the goddess Isis, who says to the goddess Re, "Say to me your name, my divine father, for a man lives only when one recites his name." See, God couldn't believe to be existent if God did not have a name. A name gave a deity power. I absolutely love God's response here. God simply says, "Ehe Asher Ehe." Now, to understand that in the Hebrew language, we must remember that in this language, there is no past, present, or future verb tenses. Instead, there is only what they call the perfect and the imperfect. The perfect simply means that the action is completed. The imperfect means that the action is not yet complete. So a translator must use the surrounding text to determine which verb tense use in English. As such, this verb haya, which means to be, can be translated in more than one way. The two most common is I am or I will be. And since this verb is in the imperfect, it means its action is not yet complete. God does not say, "My name is holy," or "My name is divine," or "Jehovah," or all these other names that we may associate with God. God simply says, need. A Jewish scholar, Gerardo Sachs, translates this also in many ways. But one in particular is, I shall be who I shall be. For him, this translation can have two different meanings. To everyone, I am something else. Or each person has a different idea of me. I would most agree with this latter translation because if there's any importance in this naming at all, it would be that identifying God for oneself is vitally important. The mere fact that Moses, the Israelites, the theologians, the translators, the philosophers wrestled with this should be help us recognize its importance, that the followers of God must have an identity for God, for themselves. Another scholar, Charles Giannotti, offers several views for interpreting and understanding this divine name of God. And one that I identify with the most is the phenomenological view. This view believes that God will reveal God's self in God's actions through history, and whatever the situation or need, God will become the solution. God cannot be defined by a single name like other gods, because God is a part of God's people's story. God's name changes as the situation needs. If God's name gives God identity, then the way in which God states God's name is fluid and can change. God's name then becomes different for different people at different times. So what is with God's name? Why would God leave it so confusing? There had to be some apparent reason for stating it this way. How are we to make sense of it? A little while ago, I read a book called God the What by Carolyn Bowler. It was in reading this book and studying this passage that I realized just how to make sense of it. The name is purposefully left to our imagination, because God will be who God will be. God. Think of it this way. Was there ever a time when you were so grateful for something somebody did for you, and you said the words thank you, but the words just seemed empty? It didn't really express the gratefulness you had inside. Well, that is because some feelings are indescribable. Our language confines us. So to define God within the realm of our language would confine God. God is beyond our imagination's ability to create one single name for God, because God is what God is, and God's action is not yet complete. I believe the way in which God is revealing God's self in this passage shows us God's unimaginable power. Power that is not forced, but rather earned by God's willingness to be vulnerable and more intimate with the Israelites, Moses, and with all of his followers. As with any intimate relationship, people open themselves up for suffering. And I believe God is opening God's self up for suffering here. The way in which God gives God's name requires an active response from Moses, the Israelites, and from all who follow God. It should give us a desire to know this God more intimately, because we must fill in the blank of God's characteristics. But in what way can we use our language, which confines us, to describe who God is for us when others may ask us? Well, like we often do in our language to describe something that's difficult, we use metaphors. Although this does not give the object or being a name, it helps us understand who or what it is. Even God, I would argue, goes on and does metaphors in verse 15 when he says, "The Lord, the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob." God is displaying God's faithful characteristic. God is and was and will continue to be God to those who accept God. So what is your metaphor or metaphors for God? Who is God to you? What metaphors best describes your understanding of who God is? If God is who God is, then God would be for me who I need God to be, and for you who you need God to be. And depending on our life's journeys or struggles, even our own metaphors for God may change. I'm going to share with you today a metaphor that I connect with to describe God. Now, you may have heard me mention a little earlier that I've had 2 brain surgeries. Some of you already know, and some of you are learning to know, that I have been on a long journey with brain cancer. So for me, God has been my divine physical therapist. God was not this pie in the sky that was going to wave a wand and ask me just because I asked for healing. But God would lead me to the knowledge and wisdom that would help bring my healing. But it was my job to do the work necessary to continue in that healing. God showed me what I had to do, but I had to do the work. My divine therapist. And through this whole journey and continuing today, another metaphor for God stands out for me. God has been and continues to be my suffering companion. When I struggle, God struggles alongside me. When I cry, God cries alongside me. And when I suffer, God suffers with me. God is my suffering companion. So what is your metaphor for God? How do you see God working in your life? We believe as they did, then what characteristics would you use in describing God? Now, maybe right away you thought of a metaphor, and maybe it will take some time, but it is important to have a name for God that you identify with. As Christians, we are called to desire an intimate relationship with God. To be intimate means we peel away at the true identity of that person. We can use metaphors as a way of identifying with God. The metaphors give us God's characteristics, which leads to identity, and identity leads to our name for God. If we do not have a name that describes the characteristics of God, we cannot identify with God. So what is be your name for God?